Thank you. God's judgment in the time of evil and affliction, it shall be well with the remnant. People, we are in a time of evil and affliction. I mean, Maxine Waters, she just really just, and we got to pray that, that this word judges that. Jeremiah 15:11. The Lord said, verily it shall be well with the remnant. And when he says verily, that means he's really, really serious. Verily, I will cause the enemy to entreat you well in the time of evil and in the time of affliction. Church, we've got to pray that over ourselves. We've got to declare that over the church. We've got to declare it over our families. And we've got to declare this over ourselves and our nation, our churches, because we're in a time of evil and affliction. Jeremiah is a book of judgment. But even in judgment, God's love is present because he is there and he is love. Fearing God is not based on being afraid of angering him, although he was very angry in this. But we don't have to fear God in that way. I fear God. But I fear God because I'm awed 14:1. The word of the Lord that came to Jeremiah concerning the dearth that begins the drought. The sword, famine, and pestilence, some of the early signs of judgment facing the land. Okay, this morning I heard one of the commentators that she just listed, it was Maria Bartiromo. She was listing every single one of the things that we're facing. China, go received tidings. There were also false prophets who spoke without divine authorization and revelation. The people being misled by ritualistic priests or false prophets is no excuse. Because the preacher told you to do it is no excuse. You don't have to go through your preacher to get to God. You have immediate access to Jesus Christ through prayer. You can go straight up to Daddy's lap. You can go straight to Father God through the blood of Jesus. And if some preacher or prophet tells you what's wrong, that's no excuse. The false prophets are defined for the first time in lacking commission by God and truth in their message, which can be shown to be false by their valueless predictions being overturned. Such false prophets are active before the close of any dispensation, Matthew 24:24. Political disruption has a spiritual cause. All political disruption. God controls the governments of nations. God controls the government of the kingdom of God. He controls civil government. He sets kings in places. He brings kings down. He controls civil governments of nations, and he controls the government of the kingdom of God. So the conflict between true and false prophets had begun. That's going on in our nation right now. There is argument right now with the true prophets and the false prophets, and they're all in a big wood. I'm not going there, not getting into it. I'm going to declare the word of the Lord and let it fall where it may. The false prophets, and this manifests more and more as Jeremiah unfolds, the false prophets will die by the sword and famine, which they predict will not come. All our words are so important, church. Our words are so important. They are so powerful. And they carry so much power. So many times people will judge people on the Facebook. And I have them judge me, of course. And all I answer to them, be it unto you according to your words. Be it however they judge me, it will be unto them according to their words. If you judge a fellow Christian, if that judgment does not stand in heaven, it will go back on you. That puts a better God in you. 14-16. The Lord said to me, the prophets prophesy lies in my name. I have not sent them, commanded them, nor spoken to them. They prophesy to you a false vision, divination, a worthless thing, and the deceit of their heart. Therefore, says the Lord, I just gave y'all a word. I just spoke a word. When I said at the end of any dispensation, there is a fighting going on between the false prophets and the prophets of God. And I said to you, that is going on right now. This is a sign. The sign that the prophets are arguing and that they're being judged and the prophets are going back and forth. That is a sign that there is a change of dispensation that is coming upon the earth. Oh! Many prophesy to be recognized, to get a name. Oh, dear God, if you just knew what this seriousness
good.
We're going to pray again. This is Jeremiah's grotto. It's one of his prayerful retreats, and he believed to be at the foot of an oak with the cross of Jesus. I picked that up out of F.F. Bruce Hobson. He has that in that F.F. Bruce commentary. He has a lot of things, a lot of stuff that he found out from somebody, information. But anyway, I thought that was, I like that story. Okay, 1-4. Then said the Lord unto me, though Moses and Samuel stood before me, yet my mind could not be toward this people. Cast them out of my sight, and let them go forth. And it shall come to pass, if they say unto you, where shall we go forth? You shall tell them, thus saith the Lord, such as for death to death, and such as for the sword to the sword, and such as for famine to the famine, and such as for the captivity to the captivity. I will appoint over them four kinds, says the Lord. The sword to slay, to devour, and destroy. I will cause them to be removed into all kingdoms of the earth because of Manasseh, son of Hezekiah, king of Judah, for that which he did in Jerusalem. Do not doubt the acts of a king, the acts of a ruler. And if the people come into agreement with them, this same judgment will fall on that nation. If Moses or Samuel, in a prayer intercession, joined Jeremiah in his prayers for Judah, the Lord's intention was settled. They couldn't change his mind. Judgment was inevitable. These men had been influential intercessors with God, and they had changed God's mind to destroy, after the golden calf thing, God was going to destroy Israel, and Moses interceded. Moses and Samuel were renowned for their power and position in God. This also shows the gravity of Judah's guilt and futility of any hope for a real change short of judgment. Judgment is God's love, saving people from their sin. 2 Kings 24:1-5. In his days, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came up. Now remember, this is what Jeremiah's prophesied about. Nebuchadnezzar's coming in. God has brought him in. God has raised him up. He is carrying a destroyer. That nature of the devil, he kills, steal, and destroy. Nebuchadnezzar was carrying the destroyer. God brought him in as an instrument of his judgment. And Jehoiakim became his servant 3 years. Then he turned and rebelled against him. The Lord, that would be the day, Jehoiakim, he, because the son only reigned for 3 months. The Lord sent against him bands of the Chaldees and bands of the Syrians and bands of the Moabites and bands of the children of Ammon, and sent them against Judah to destroy it according to the word of the Lord, which he spoke by his servants, the prophets. That would be Jeremiah. Surely at the commandment of the Lord, this came upon Judah to remove them out of sight for the sins of Manasseh, according to all that he did, and also for the innocent blood that he shed. For he filled Jerusalem with innocent blood, which the Lord would not pardon. Now the rest of the acts of Jehoiakim and all that he did, are they not written in the book of Chronicles of Kings and Judah? On Sunday night, we have started reading the book Touching Heaven, which is about written by this doctor who has, in his he has raised the dead. He's been taken to heaven. He's been set at the deathbed of people, and they have been taken to heaven, and they have given him stories about heaven. So we have just started it. But he said when he was a young man, just starting in ministry, I think he was in New York. Was it New York he was in when all the babies came out? There were aborted babies. and they were brought in the pathology lab. Was in New York, is that where it was? It was at, yes.
In the preparing lab in New York.
And you, I was thinking it was New York, but maybe not. It was at, yeah, he was prepared. Barrels of aborted babies came in. Full term. Having all their arms and their legs. Some of them arms and legs taken off. Children, I will destroy my people since they return not from their place. verse 15:10. Now this is Jeremiah crying to God. Alas, my mother, that you gave me birth, a man with whom the whole land strives and contends. I have neither lent nor borrowed. Yet everyone curses me. Poor Jeremiah. Nobody liked him. They didn't want to hear what he had to say. Delivering the preceding oracle is too much for the grief-stricken prophet. We're not going to get grief-stricken. We may weep with tears before the Lord, and tears may fall out of our eyes for our nation, but we're not going to get so grief-stricken that we have grabbed hold of the mighty power of God Almighty through the mighty blood of Jesus Christ and take back our nation. Verse 11, which is where we start. Okay. I guess I'll run over a few minutes here, but not much, because I'll try to stay on focus. The Lord said, verily, it shall be well with the remnant. Now remember that verily means he means business. It says verily twice. I will cause the enemy to entreat you well in the time of evil and in time of now he's required after this little conversation with God to release another oracle of judgment. 12-14. God speaking. Can a man break iron? Iron from the north or bronze? Your wealth and your treasures I will give as plunder without charge because of all your sins throughout your country. I will enslave you to your enemies in a land you do not know. For my anger will kill tinder and fire that will burn against you. The fire of the Lord, the fire kindled in his anger. Lord, you and I have received Holy Ghost fire at Pentecost. You and I have another fire of God. It's the fire of God that burns everything away that is evil. We're going to come forth like a mighty army. Going back to my notes of 2008, I wrote this in here. I'm not even sure all the information. This is a quote from the Morning Star that I preached on the throne of the Lord, which was dated April the 27th, 2000. I didn't go back to that message, but I hope I got it. Some of the early messages I preached, I don't know. I do not have the date of the journal or the author. It is an eloquent exhortation on the fire of the Lord. I believe this describes the visitation and judgment of Israel, as well as all who are bearing fruit worthy of, who are not bearing fruit worthy of repentance. Remember, I wrote this in 2008. Come to the rest of us. When the Lord comes in glory, this is Morning Star. Those who believe in his Son will be glorified. Those who do not believe will be consumed by his presence. The only thing left standing in that day will be that which is of the nature of his Son. All else shall be consumed. The fear of the Lord is not based on God's heart or attitude toward us. His thoughts toward us have always been and will always be born of love. Our sin and unrighteousness cannot stand in his presence. Romans 1:18. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. New Testament, new covenant. Because that which they be known of God is manifest in them. For God has shown it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Don't give me no excuses. God has shown it to them. The invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen. Don't give me no excuses. That you don't know no must turn toward both of these winds. If we will turn toward the Lord and grow in the knowledge of his love and the truth of Christ in us, God will progressively purge iniquity from our lives. Progressively. We will be transformed into the image of his Son and grow into mature sons and daughters that he desires. Then we will find the revelation power and spiritual authority we need to manifest God's kingdom and destroy the works of the devil. That's the plan. Manifest God's kingdom and destroy the works of the devil. But as this process continues, we must not leave off the fear of the Lord until we're completely transformed by love and truth. We must continue to depart from evil by maintaining God's fear. I can't what it keeps me from sin is fear of God. But your flesh, you know, won't always say. He is a consuming fire, and his love for us will not protect us if we do not begin if we do begin to play with sin and evil. The devil comes with the stupidity. God is coming in his presence, and only the holy will be able to remain in that day. I speak without boast, ever. This is 2008. That we're blessed in this church with his presence. The first day church is sacrifice. The second day is ordinances. And the third day is his presence. Church, with all that we've been through, he hasn't taken his presence. This is our calling. The Lord has graced us.